Welcome to the Words to Empower television broadcast, featuring Frank and Jackie Stewart, pastor and first lady of the Acts Ministries. And now, Frank and Jackie Stewart.
Welcome back to the Words to Empower broadcast with Pastor Frank. I'm Lady J. We're so glad you joined us on today. We're continuing this study and series that we begun several weeks ago, talking about conversations between Jesus and individuals in the Bible. We kind of addressed the woman at the well of Samaria and Jesus' conversation and Nicodemus' conversation with Jesus. And today we're going to have and deal with a conversation between Jesus and Paul.
Yeah, you know, as we have stated, we look at Jesus ministering to the 5,000 men beside women and children, 4,000 men beside women and children, ministering to them, feeding them. We see Jesus ministering to huge groups in the Bible, but one of the things that we have zeroed in on is Jesus ministering to individuals. And it is many, many examples of Jesus ministering to individuals. He took time to do that. Mm-hmm. And one-on-one. And we want to kind of eavesdrop, you know, on these conversations, because they were put here for us. Put here for us, not written for the people, but written for us. And we're going to talk about Paul and Jesus conversation that they had. And this is the first conversation Paul is going to have with Jesus. And we can get into that, because Paul, we just came out of the 4th of July. And Paul was a religious person that thought he was free. He really thought he was free. He thought he was doing the work of God. And he was in bondage. But Jesus and Paul, they're going to have a conversation, and it's a very interesting conversation they're going to have. So, First Lady, it's quite a bit of reading. So, how much do you want to read on today? It's 19 verses here. Where do you want to stop at here on today?
We'll be reading Acts chapter 9. We'll start at verse 1, and since we have about 19 verses, we can stop midway for today.
Because some of this is Paul's conversation with Ananias and the messenger of God that comes to Paul. So, okay, let's start this conversation. Mm-hmm. Paul and Jesus.
All right, Acts chapter 9, verse 1 through verse number 9. 1 through 9. Let's read the first 9 verses. This is the King James Version, and we want you to read along with us for the New King James Version. And you can turn in your Bibles, your PCs, your electronic devices, your tablets, whatever you have. Read along with us the Word of the Lord. And just to remind you, Jesus is talking to Paul. He is a Hebrew of the Hebrews. He's been circumcised on the 8th day. He is a man who's touching the law. He's blameless. He is a Pharisee of the Pharisees. He is one who is set at the feet of Gamaliel, a awesome teacher, Jewish teacher in Israel. He has a pedigree and a resume as long as your arm. You have to understand, this is somebody who is not only religious, but this is someone who is practicing the religion that he knows. Okay? Yeah. So this is Acts chapter 9, verses 1 through 9, and it reads for us today. Then Saul, still breathing threats and murder against the disciples of the Lord, went to the high priest and asked letters from him to the synagogues of Damascus, so that if he found anyone who were of the way, that's of the Christian way, whether men or women, he might bring them bound to Jerusalem. As he journeyed, he came near Damascus, and suddenly a light shone round about him from heaven. Then he fell to the ground and heard a voice saying unto him, Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? And he said, Who are you, Lord? Then the Lord said, I am Jesus whom you are persecuting. It is hard for you to kick against the goads. So he, trembled and astonished, said, Lord, what do you want me to do? Then the Lord said to him, Arise and go into the city, and you will be told what you must do. And the men who journeyed with him stood speechless, hearing a voice but seeing no one. Then Saul arose from the ground, and when his eyes were opened, he saw no one. But they led him by the hand and brought him into Damascus. And he was 3 days without sight, and neither ate nor drank.
Amen. So when you see this conversation, it's a very powerful conversation that Jesus is going to have with Paul. And just Paul's background, as you said, he was very religious. So you can be very religious and not have a relationship with God.
Religiously wrong.
You know, good intentions.
Yes.
Good intentions. Doing everything you think God wants you to do. Mm-hmm. And yet and still being completely against God. Fighting against God and think you're working for God.
Yes.
Now, if this can happen... Yes, if this can happen to Apostle Paul, it can happen to any of us. That's why it's so important that we adhere to the Word of God and not our traditions, not what we have thought the Word of God said, but what God's Word actually says. So here is Saul, he's called Saul, and it said breathing threats and murder against the disciples of the Lord. So Paul, he wanted to, if you worship Jesus, he considered that blasphemy. That was a death sentence. That was idolatry. And they were to be stoned to death. And he put many to death. He put many in prison. So now he has orders from the high priest.
Yes.
He's received legal rights. The high priest has given him a document that gives him legal rights to go and persecute the people of God. He has a warrant in essence that he can go and find them and persecute them and not get in trouble with the Roman government or other officials because they recognize the Jewish law.
So he has gotten permission to go and do this from the high priest. He's the highest ruling religious leader of the land for the Israelites. So it's not like he's out on a tangent just looking like he's the only one who wants to persecute the saints and persecute the Church of Jesus Christ. And so he has the backing of religious leaders. And sometimes you can have backing of people who are wrong as well.
Yes.
And so he has not only been backed, deputized, he has his warrant in his hand. He's going after Christians. And when we read those of the way, when the Bible, and that's a capital W in your Bible, when you see that, whenever you see those of the way, it has reference to the Christians, those who believe in Jesus, those who have relationship with him, those who have been saved by the blood of the Lamb. And so the Apostle Paul, he's Saul right now. And he is on a mission, and that mission is to capture, to imprison anyone, men, women, boys, girls, it doesn't matter. He wanted to capture them and bring them back to Jerusalem in stocks, in chains, in bonds, so that they can be put on trial for blasphemy, for treason, for worshiping a false god, so he thought. But when he begins to go to Damascus, he has an encounter on this road to Damascus, which will revolutionize and change his entire life. It will change his way of thinking. It will change what he thought was right before. He will come into the knowledge, the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ, where he understands, I've been doing the wrong thing. I've been trying to do the will of God and at the same time, all at once, doing the wrong thing. And so he's on his beast. He's traveling to Damascus and he is knocked off his beast of burden by the blinding light that's brighter than the noonday sun. And he hears a voice from heaven that calls him by name and says, Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? And he understands that only the voice from heaven has to be God. And he responds by saying, Lord, Kyrios, Lord, he is the worshiper of the one true and living God. So he's responding back to that one true and living God, not knowing that it's Jesus. And he says, Lord, you know, who art thou? He asked the questions because he said, I don't understand. I'm thinking that I am doing the right thing. This conversation that he's having with the voice that's thundering from heaven, that's speaking to him from glory. He understands when the voice speaks back to him and says, I am Jesus, who you're persecuting. I could imagine everything within him dropped. His whole way of thinking, his whole ideology, what he's been taught from childhood. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord, and he has not associated that one Lord with Jesus. He has word. He has the letter. All of it's going to come together through this conversation with Jesus.
So he's here and he's going with his mind made up, and God knows how to get our attention. So as you foresaid, so light come from heaven. You have to wonder you got to wonder at this point, what is Paul thinking at this point? And as you said, the voice said to him, why are you persecuting me? Now that's a pretty powerful question, because Paul has got to be confused at this point. I'm not persecuting anybody from heaven. I'm persecuting these Christians.
That's what he thinks.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'm not persecuting you. So this is confusing to him. So now he says something here. Who are you, Lord? Who are you? And the one thing we're going to see about Paul is that he is so honest, and we can see why God will use him in such a powerful way, such an incredible way to write most of the New Testament. Now, you got to think about it. This is the man that's going to write most of the New Testament. He is persecuting. He is killing Christians. And he's doing it because he thinks they are wrong. They're going against the great God, Jehovah. They're worshiping an idol. Jesus was not the Son of God, and so forth and so on. So now Jesus, and that's what we're talking about in this series, is going to have a conversation with Paul. There's going to be a brief conversation here with Paul, talking to him. And one of the most amazing things that I recognize about Paul, to me, is just unbelievable. His ability to immediately change. His ability to change from what he had been indoctrinated and taught his whole life. Unlike the disciples, they was taught about the Pentateuch and so forth. They was taught the laws of Moses and all of that. They was taught about the prophets. But Paul, he was taught to a greater degree. He had degrees. He had been one of the most educated people of his time. And Agrippa tells him, much learning does make you mad. Paul was that incredible student of the Word of God.
Yes. Yes.
So he thought he was doing everything right, but the voice came. Jesus is talking to him now. Jesus is talking to him. And it is amazing that he's not coming to destroy Paul. He's not coming to kill him. He's coming to convert him. Now, it's going to take the folks a while to get used to that, because the one that was killing them now is going to be joining them, and and they're not going to be, they're not going to be too happy about it. Some folks, they're not going to be happy about him. The one who was murdering Christians are now with the Christians, and some of them just not going to believe it because he makes this turn so quick. He makes this turn in his faith so quick. But the one thing that Paul will come to understand, that the God he was worshiping is the same God that sent Jesus. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. So it's not two, it's just one. Mm-hmm. And Paul following the traditions of his father, and he hadn't opened himself up to the revelation. We're going to take a quick break, and we're going to come right back to this conversation between Jesus and Paul. Greetings in the wonderful name of Jesus Christ. My name is Frank Stewart. I'm the pastor of Acts Ministries in Conway and also in North Little Rock.
We also have an outreach on John Barrow where we partnership with the city and other ministries there. I want to invite you to partner with us in this ministry. I want to invite you to share with us in propagating the gospel of Jesus Christ. There are many things that we're doing and we're going to continue to do. We have a vision in mind on how to be a blessing to the communities that we're in. So we're asking you to be a partner with us. I believe that God will reward you and He will multiply you. So join us in the Acts ministry in sponsoring not only this broadcast, but what we're doing in the great city of Little Rock, North Little Rock, and also Conway. God bless you.
Blessings to each and every one of you. We thank you for joining us. We want you to continue to walk with us as we go through a new study. We're going to be having conversations with Jesus and individuals in Scripture. You don't want to miss this powerful study as we reveal and expose some of the things that transpire with Jesus and individuals in the Bible as He has one-on-one conversations.
Greetings in the wonderful name of Jesus Christ. My name is Frank Stewart.
And I'm Jacqueline Stewart.
We want to invite you to our program. I am the pastor of Acts Ministries, located in Conway, Arkansas, and also in North Little Rock, Arkansas.
So join us every Sunday at 4 p.m. right here on VTN for our Words to Empower television broadcast.
Now we're back to this incredible conversation Paul is having with Jesus, Saul, if you will, and just take some time to think about this conversation that he's having with a murderer. He's killing innocent people, but God looks on the heart. We look at the outward appearance. God looks on the heart. God knew that Paul thought he was doing God's will.
He understands that I gotta change my way of thinking. I've got to change what I've been taught. I've got to change my mindset. I've got to change what I had in my heart, what I've been thinking all these years, all this time, because what I've been thinking has been wrong. You can think something for so long that you think you are the only one who's right,
yes,
and everyone else is wrong.
Right.
And God has to show you,
absolutely,
you are wrong. Apostle Paul, Saul at this point, has to be convicted by God. It wasn't the high priest, the chief priest, one of the disciples that convicted him. It was not, you know, those Christians that convicted him. It was God. And sometimes it takes God to convict people and get them in a conversation with Him,
yes,
to let them see, listen, you're going the wrong way, but I can use you.
Yes.
You're on the wrong path, but I can use this zeal. I can use this passion. I can use this knowledge that you have. I can use you for the glory of God, but it's going to take you hearing the voice of God. You know, we often say, speak, Lord, for your servant hears you. Samuel had to be told by Eli, the next time you hear that voice, Eli's just a boy. He doesn't know the voice of God. He doesn't know. He doesn't have relationship with God like that. So he has to develop and grow and mature in his relationship with God. And it starts with, speak, Lord, for your servant hears you. And when you can hear what the Spirit is saying to the church, you're on a good path. You're on your way to understanding and knowledge and wisdom that flows from the throne of God. You're on your way to the right path and not to be continuing on the wrong path.
He's astonished and he's, the Bible says he's trembling and astonished. Trembling, meaning that he is overcome
by the presence and the power of God, and the light knocked him off his beast. But that word astonished, he's puzzled. Because you got to realize, he'd been taught this all his life. This is what he believes. His whole life, he believes this, and he's been super educated in this. Not like the other apostles. They were educated as Jewish, normally Jewish young men and Jewish children were educated. But Paul had went beyond that. He was one of those spokesmen. He had sat at the feet of Gamaliel. He had went to the best universities, and his whole life was given to this. So now when the Lord asked him, when the Lord told him, "Why are you persecuting me?" Saul responded to the question that Jesus asked him by asking a question: "Who are you?" Because you got to understand that they believe, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one," Deuteronomy 6:4. That they built everything around that one God, and that scripture actually says that God is one. It just doesn't say it's one God. It's actually saying God is one. So when he says this, he is totally confused. He is shocked. The Bible says he's astonished. He's puzzled. And even in the midst of this puzzlement, which is so powerful, he asked God, "What do you want me to do?" That is a 180 degree turn. Man, that speaks volume about the character of God. Because even when we see the apostles that had been with Jesus a long time, it took them a while to make the shift. Paul makes this shift immediately after all his life. Now, one thing the Lord Jesus says to Paul, he says, "Hard for you to kick against," King James Version says, "the pricks," or New King James Version says, "the goads." In other words, it's hard. You fighting me, you're hurting you. It's kind of like keep those animals in. Keep them from running up against the wall or the fence and running over the wall. What they did was put these sharp pricks on the wall, so if they pushed against it, they would actually hurt themselves. And what God is, what the Lord is saying to Paul, the more you fight me, the more you hurt you. Isn't that amazing? Mm-hmm. But he thinks he's doing what God wants him to do. Mm-hmm. That's what he thinks he's doing. And if we're not careful in our day and time, in where we are now, in this world, in this country, if we don't seek God, we'll be in the same situation Paul was in. Fighting something and not knowing what we're fighting is God. Same thing happened on the day of Pentecost. The day of Pentecost, they were making fun and began to ridicule something that actually was God. The Bible says they began to mock. Yes. They began to mock what God was doing, but they didn't recognize God. That's why you have to really stay focused on God, because God will shift. He doesn't stay the same. He is moving. He is constantly moving. His character does not change. His integrity does not change. But as far as what God is doing, as he's progressive and he's moving forward, from the time Adam sinned, you see human government, you see law, you see him moving in grace, you see God moving. And here, God shifted. The Son of God came to the world, came into the world, and most of the religious people, they missed it. And that's something that really helps us today, because we can miss it. They missed it. And when this happened, Paul said, "What do you want me to do? I can't get past that." How quickly he can shift after your whole life believing something, and all of a sudden when you realize it is wrong. Even some of us, when we realize things is wrong, we don't shift like this. Paul was able to make a shift. You know, you look at Peter, it took a long time for him to recognize what he had preached on the day of Pentecost is actually what he came to understand at Cornelius' house in Acts chapter 10. So Paul said, "What would you have me to do?" And the answer that God gives him, First Lady, is a very powerful answer. He did not tell Paul what to do here. Right. He told him what to do to get the answer, but he didn't tell him what to do.
So he told him in verse number 7, he says, the men that were with him, they testify to actually what's happening there. They hear this voice, but they don't see anyone either. And then the men arose from, when Saul arose from the ground, he opened his eyes. He was unable to see. Physically blinded because he had a spiritual blindness that God wanted to open him up to. So God allows that blinding light, brighter than the noonday sun, to actually blind him physically so that he could see spiritually. And even though he's going to turn and ask, Lord, what would you have me to do? He's got to contemplate some things. He's got to meditate on some things. He's got to think about these things. He's going to be blind for 3 days without sight. He's going to be fasting, neither eating nor drinking for 3 days. He has an opportunity to hear from God because what he has acquired all his life, he's going to have to change. And God gives him that opportunity, these 3 days, being blinded, fasting and praying, not being able to see, going to on into the city of Damascus, waiting on the man of God, Ananias, so that when he meets up with him, he's going to be able to pray for him, lay hands on him, and have him recover of his sight and be baptized. He's going to get the whole package. But it's going to start with hearing the voice of God, knowing the voice of God, and following the voice of God.
Man, that is praise. Father, in Jesus' name, we thank you for your word. We thank you for what you said to us. And we embrace the conversation, Lord God, that you've had in the word of God. And we say to you, Lord God, feel free. We pray that in our prayers, you will speak to us. And we pray, Lord, that we would obey what you're saying unto us. In Jesus' name.
Amen. We thank you for joining us on today. We're continuing these conversations between Jesus and individuals. So don't hesitate to join us back here next week. We want to continue. We want to dive into all of these conversations because Jesus is a one-on-one person. He loves people and he wants to speak to us individually as well as collectively. Until next week, God bless you is our prayer. Don't forget, you can always connect with us at WTE.org on our website. And if you want to send in your prayer request, you can always send it in at prayer@axwte.org. That's prayer@axwte.org. We'd love to connect and pray with you there. Until next week, be blessed, my brother. Be blessed, my sister. And we love you to life.
The Axe Ministries is located at 1423 Ingram in Conway and 1224 Franklin Street in North Little Rock. Call 501-329-2055 or go to axeministriesonline.org for more information. We would love you to partner with our ministry. Please go to our website, axeministriesonline.org, and find out how you can partner with us. For your gifts, please click on the Donate Online button or text the amount you wish to give to 501-302-4242.